Melvin B. Emma. Melvin C. Victoria. Get it.
I've always believed in girl power.
You better believe it!
Girl power, equalization between the sexes. Mm.
The film is self-parodying, and the girls, you know, are very good at, you know, taking the mickey out of themselves and having fun with the whole Spice Girls thing that's going on, the whole phenomenon.
And they burst through that door right there.
Thank you very much.
Since the Beatles films, really, I can't think of a single English film that's been made or a reason to make a film that seems so purely for the sort of the pop of it, the fun of it.
Balloons, cakes, sandwiches, fun.
It's all very tongue-in-cheek, and there is reality in there, but, you know, there's a sense of comedy with it.
Hello!
Hello!
Hello.
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 It was not just like a sort of excuse for the Spice Girls to sing some songs. It's a really clever script and a good laugh.
Richard is one of the funniest people I've worked with ever. He's very funny.
Ha 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 ha!
He came up to me and he said, "Thank you so much for letting me be in the film." And I was like, "Oh my God, do you know what? That's Richard E. Grant, and he's thanking me for being in the film." And it was like, I was going, "No, thank you for being in the film." Every morning we'd come in, you know, we'd come in with no makeup on, our hair down, and we're all knackered. We all come in with wet hair, no makeup. Richard just used to make us laugh all the time. He's going, "No, thank you," and I'm going, "No, thank you." He's very, you know, irate and mad and, you know, just brilliant. He's a bit like his character, actually.
Do you want me to go after the paparazzi chief? I could start kicking asses if you like. Stir things up a bit.
Well, there's no need for any stirring.
Put a couple of cats among a few pigeons.
Leave the pigeons alone.
Watch the feathers fly. Get some...
Richard E. Grant, he plays, like, our manager.
A slightly unhinged, neurotic, road stroke manager.
Look at that! More stories, more evil harpoons from the press.
It's all lies, I tell you! Bring me a straitjacket!
Richard E. Grant, who was playing Clifford, his character, I just love it. It is fantastic.
Clifford is neurotic, and I just think that's like, Clifford, chill out.
Chill out, Clifford. He's all irate and annoyed and uptight and frustrated with everything and anyone around him. He's neurotic, highly strung, out of control, he's manic.
Really uptight.
Uptight!
He's not the head boss, but he's like the middleman. So, you know, it's always shoot the messenger, basically. So if anything goes wrong, it's on his shoulders.
We've got this character who is the chief.
Yes.
Between him and Clifford, they kind of run things. But they don't really, because the girls always do what they want to do anyway. Which is why Clifford starts getting mad, going mad, because he can't control them. And in fact, in real life, no, you can't control them anyway.
I'm going to stand up to the chief, be assertive. I'm going to ask him, no, tell him, the girls are going to have the morning off.
The answer is no, Clifford.
Chief?
The girls cannot have the morning off.
Of course not, Chief. The fact that they've been working really hard and they're at the point of exhaustion is...
Irrelevant.
Irrelevant.
He has very little power and gets stomped over by them.
So let's go from the top again. Okay. Chum, 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 coming downstairs.
Bye, Clifford!
No, 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 hold on, hold on, hold on. Where are you going?
We're going home to sleep. We'll see you tomorrow afternoon.
Yeah. No, I'm sorry. There's been a change of plan. The schedule's too tight.
What?
We've got the competition winners in the morning.
Oh, God!
Ah, nice one, Clifford.
You nearly had us there, Clifford.
You're not really going to tell him fibs, are you?
But it's basically our emotional punch bag. You know, if anything goes wrong, he gets it from both ends.
You better watch it, mate.
Yeah, and from now on, no more Mr. Nice Spice.
But he's been a complete joy to work with, actually. Really good.
Acting with Richard E. Grant is, like, unbelievable.
And it's nice to have good actors like that around, because you feel it sort of helps you and hopefully rubs onto you a bit.
Come on, boys, capture that magic.
I'm playing Piers Cuthbertson Smythe, who's trying to make a documentary about the spices.
Posh one! Posh one!
Which one is that?
The one that looks posh!
Alan Cummings is... He's really funny. They do this scene, right? And he's got his little team around him and he's trying to catch us with his little documentary crew everywhere we go and it always goes wrong.
There is a child in the water! Get that! I want a close-up of that wet...
Yes, all I'm getting is you shouting!
You shoot them!
Because he is pretty dippy and his crew, the cameraman and the soundman, are like the worst you could ever wish to work with.
Sound running.
Excuse me, would you mind not filming, please?
Cut.
So it's not a recipe for success.
We're on a boat trip and he's chugging along behind in his little crappy boat trying to get us and he goes overboard and the sound man goes, but all I can hear is splashing, man.
I've got a loud splash there, Piers.
In the film, we wanted to show a lot of things that, you know, really do happen. And paparazzi photography is a bane of our lives. Is that the right expression? They really are. They're everywhere. Do you know what I mean? And it's like, I mean, we take it to the extreme in the film, which you'll see, but it's like you wonder when you go to bed at night whether there's one going to be hiding under your bed. Do you know what I mean? That is what they're like. They just seem to know where you're going to be and when you're going to be there. It's so bizarre. So we wanted to share that and we thought we want someone quite eerie, quite scary for that part. Richard O'Brien was perfect because he's a pretty spooky guy, isn't he?
8:55, you in the lift, picking your nose, another bogey breakfast. He's good.
And now Emma is demonstrating how to deal with intrusive photographers.
That's good! Do it again! I find that was very good.
It was quite funny. I was at home the day that the one of the tabloid newspapers had a two-page spread on all the celebrities who'd been asked to take part in the Spice Girls movie. And my name wasn't there. And secretly inside, I was weeping.
I really need some great actors in the film. And I was thinking about, you know, Richard E. Grant.
Jerry and Emma said, you are going to be in this film, aren't you? I said, yes, of course. So, you know, it's flattered that even you knew of my existence.
Look at these fools taking part in this silly movie, eh? There's no way I would do it if they asked me, and I'm not even going to go and see it.
I was too excited to think, actually, when I got this job. I'd been in a state of nervous flux for about 2 months.
And then that very morning, I bumped into the director who said, would you like to be in the film? I said, Bob, I'd love to!
That's the thing that I find extraordinary.
So it shows you how deep I am, and I couldn't wait. I've been looking forward to it ever since then.
But it is like my dream come true to work on this film. I bludgeoned my way into this.
It does read a bit like a who's who, the cast list, but it's not meant to be a gimmicky thing. It's just that hopefully we've got the best people for the job.
The people that we've chosen to work with us on the film have all been really down to earth and just complete fun.
People who've been involved in the film up to now, the actors who've come in and done a day, or, you know, people like Jules Holland or Roger Moore or Barry Humphries, have loved it.
We need a new angle, Brad. I mean, who cares if the Spice Girls get to number one yet again? Who cares if they climb to the top of Mount Everest on an ostrich? Or if they find a cure for deja vu?
Not me.
Or if they find a cure for deja vu?
Not me.
It's down to their energy that that permeates the whole process of the film.
When the rabbit of chaos is pursued by the ferret of disorder through the fields of anarchy, it is time to hang your pants on the hook of darkness.
And we've learned something off everybody that's been on set, down to the crew, down to all the celebrities that's been in it. So it's one big, you know, bundle of learning experiences.
We've got, you know, good actors who, you know, like Claire Rushbrook, say, from Six and Lies at one end, and we've got Barrymore, who we all know, you know, who's a very strong comedian. And you wouldn't necessarily expect to see them in the same film.
Right then, Spice Girls, break a metal.
It's 5 days in the life of five girls.
Five girls, five lives, one story.
Who are completely different in the way they look, in the way they act, and the way they, you know, just generally behave.
Well, it's about 5 days in the life of the Spice Girls. But they've changed it ever so slightly as I've come on. It's now about 5 days in the life of a bus driver who happened to be driving these five girls. It's just, you know. It has nothing to do with him anymore. We're now changing the script, and it's now about my bus and Dennis, the bus driver.
My character's trying to cajole them and make sure that they're on time and that they turn up for this live performance.
It's my job to see that you turn up.
5 days in the life of us, working up to a big live performance at the end of it.
I hate to interrupt. There's the small matter of an extremely live gig on Saturday.
All right, we're coming.
And there are 5,000 screaming people of all ages there. One of their best friends has got pregnant and is in the hospital having a baby. So, you know, I'd sort of go into cryogenic meltdown because I assume they're not going to turn up. So I know that my head's on the line and, you know, the whole thing will collapse.
Okay. So this is the plan. The band starts up, the fans go wild, the lights come on, and I walk center stage and hang myself.
And it involves then a chase sequence that goes around London. And then at the, you know, the 11th and 59th second hour, they turn up and, you know, pull it off.
I love those girls!
There's some fun parts, there's some serious parts, there's some action parts, there's some romantic parts.
Maybe you should take your top off, Jerry.
So, you know, traditional chase movie.
Get out of the way!
Come on, what are you doing? What's the matter? Are you flying? Put your foot down!
The whole film is set in London. You know, I mean, our bus has got a great big huge Union Jack down the side.
We wanted to show a lot of the capital because this is our home and home is where the heart is, and it's such a beautiful place. And I think when you live in London, you don't appreciate it.
It's something that we all felt really strongly about, because as much as we love going abroad, you know, because we've done a lot of travelling over the last couple of years, it's nice to be at home in Britain. You know, we're proud to be British and we're proud of the Union Jack, so we get it everywhere from dresses to the sides of buses.
Hey! That's my bus!
Yeah, the Union Jack pops up everywhere.
The script is not set at all. It can't be because, you know, we like to do what comes naturally. That's the way we've always been, really.
I never stick to the script. I don't think any of us really. You know, we interpret it all in our own words. We contribute our own little sparkle on top of it all.
Oh, no!
Melanie puts her old nose in there and I put my, you know, whatever I say. It's very natural, it's got to be really, otherwise it just wouldn't work.
I mean, I think that's the good thing about playing yourself rather than playing a part. You know, it is really good fun and we can basically do what we want to do.
They're playing versions of themselves and they're really kind of fun and up and witty, so they're great.
People say to me, God, you know, you never smile, you always look really miserable, you know, you do this look. It's nice to be able to, you know, show people what you are really like as well. I mean, I've got a few funny lines in there, a very dry sense of humour, and the film's enabled me to, you know, to let that out and basically show people what I'm really like.
I put them up there, I can bring them down!
What we've always said from day one is, you know, we want to have a lot of say in what's going on. You know, we do that with our music, because we write our own music, our choreography, the way we dress. We like to have a say in everything, because that's part of it and we enjoy that.
Just the ideas have come, like Kim Fuller, who wrote some of the script, has been away with us to, you know, find out what we're like, what we say. We've known Kim for about 3 or 4 years now, so he's like a friend.
It's the girls' image. I mean, they're very engaging, they're very self-parodying, they're fun. There's no side to them as such.
So he knows exactly, you know, what sort of things to do, and that the scenes we've said, right, actually this happened when we were in such and such, we could put that in the film, that's funny, do you know what I mean? So there's little bits in there that have actually happened.
It is five real people acting as themselves.
They've given me everything I could ask for, basically, in just, A, you know, their natural talent and professionalism.
We've done this before.
Oh, no more.
Well, this one.
This is the actual costume that Wonder Woman wore.
That organised what characters we should be.
Yeah,
look at us. And look at Jerry. And it looked.
One thing we really like about Bob is that he's had a very, he's put us on a very long rein. He's let us do basically what we wanted to do. It's not heavily directed. You know, we're very, I would say, spontaneous in the, you know, the way we operate. So he was very loose in that way. But then, you know, he did steer the ship in the right way, I think.
The great thing about this film is that you get to make it up as you go along, really. That's the best thing. And I know the character appears as quite sketchy.
What I want to do with this documentary is show the real Spice Girls. You know, I want to break through the show business side. I want to crash right through it and reveal the truth.
Well, that's fine. Just as long as you crash through the showbiz facade on schedule and don't get in anybody's way.
But they sort of say to you when you take the job that they want you to improvise and make it, and it always, every scene stretches and you get new lines and stuff. And the writers are there to give you bits. So I really like that.
Yeah, it's what a smile costs, I think.
Action Alien!
Action Alien!
Get off! What are you doing?
What you're looking at is an alien spaceship designed because the Spice Girls are so famous that even aliens need their autograph. So the film required that some spaceship should arrive. I did a little sketch and somebody took me seriously and built it.
Victoria said, yeah, we've got 4 days. And I thought,
come on, chop chop, hurry it up.
Obviously, it's been some long days.
They've been very professional. We've kept absolutely to schedule.
The schedule is so tight, we even have to rehearse in the dressing room.
During making this film, we have done loads of things at the same time. There's always people coming down, you know, whether it's magazines, competition winners, whether it's, you know, promotion.
You know, if they're not doing this, they're having to do publicity or commercials or recording the next album.
It's been organised chaos, like we've been recording the album.
I'm giving you everything, all that joy can bring, this I swear.
I give you everything.
And we've almost recorded the soundtrack to the album as we went along with the film, so this soundtrack really does fit the film.
The pressure on them seems huge to an outsider.
I thought they'd be nice, I hoped they'd be nice. But they're lovely. They're even lovelier than I thought. It's been great.
And I'm sure it does help that there are five of them. But if it does get too much, they can, you know, club together and say, basta.
It is like a girls' gang, us five. You know, we stick together. It's quite nice. It's like a bit of backup. And that's another thing. When I'm naughty, I've got backup.
I'm really sorry, officer, but the thing was we were late for a show, so we were in a hurry. We didn't hurt anybody, and we're just really sorry. We promise never, ever to do it again.
The other thing that I find intriguing about it is because there's no Diana Ross and the background Supremes situation of one person being dominant, they all kind of balance each other out in a way that I never really anticipated. I imagine that there would be one obvious leader.
I wouldn't say there's a leader. I mean, in different areas, you know, we all lead in different areas, really, but there's not one leader who takes over. And I think now we just know how to treat each other.
I think some people just don't know their lines. Don't
know. Well, yeah, well,
I'm sweating over my lines and then they don't
know. OK, Clifford, but don't push us too far. Spice Girls are five different people, just like everybody's different in the world, so it's just... It's comfortable because we're being ourselves, we're not being anything else but ourselves.
Why do people stereotype us all the time? It's like really calm with us five because it doesn't sink in, we don't realise what's going on around us, do you know what I mean? Because we are, you know, the centre of it. So everything's really quite normal to us, it's just everybody like on the outside going a bit, whoa!
Take that sweet out of your mouth! I'm trying to run up and I'm like an arsehole bullet fire! Right, now,
like the girls know that I do, you know, need a cuddle now and again and said it's going to be all right, you know, and they know that. I know that Jerry needs a good cuddle sometimes. We all know each other very well and we can all suss each other out when she's having a bad day and we say, oh, stay away, or when, you know, so we all know things like that now.
And I think that's a huge part of their strength.
Just your power is all we need.
I tell you what is really, really nice about this movie is, you know, obviously it's got a lot of our old songs on there, so for Spice fans it might bring a bit of nostalgia.
You hear a lot of new tracks. We've got a nice slow one, we've got a nice salsa one, you know, there's going to be quite a few that are on there that we've just written days ago. So it's very fresh.
As fresh as newly cut grass.
And very in the film kind of vibe. So it'll all kind of work together.
One of the main tracks that is on this movie was actually written on the set. So, you know, it's really appropriate. You know, it really captures the moment.
Yeah, well, tell me what I want, what I really, really want.
When we got together, it was something that we wanted to do. We said to ourselves, we're not just a band, we want to try everything. Do you know what I mean? Some of us did do acting before, some of us did dancing before, some of us singing, so we wanted to incorporate everything. And that was one of the first things we said, it would be really great if we could do a movie.
We always wanted to go out and conquer the world, and it was like, it's a bit of a joke, really, do you know what I mean? And we're just pushing it to the boundaries and seeing how far we can go. So we always wanted to do a movie. And we always wanted to be ourselves in the movie.
We said this film is a parody of our lives, and it is.
And just have a laugh, really.
Even if you've never heard of the Spice Girls, I think you will enjoy it because it's very entertaining. And it feels good while we're making it, so if that means anything. But I think it'll be great. My mum's going to like it anyway.
Thank you very much.